is, as the as the chairperson told, pre-IVF ART or IVF hysteroscopy, always there is a lot of people telling that yes for all patients, and also some people tell there is no for all patients. So we will look into that. So what is this hysteroscopy? It is to view the inside the uterus. That is, it is derived from a Greek word. So what we are viewing is that we are potentially collapsed space of the uterine cavity is being distended by fluid usually, and we are seeing the space of inside the uterine cavity. That is the place where the embryo get implanted and grow into the baby. But if you look into the literature, way back in 1998, there is this study from my Indian International Society for Gynec Endoscopy, and the positive hysteroscopic findings were found in many as 15% despite having normal HSG and no suggestive history of uterine lesion. And most of the cases diagnosed as unexplained uterine infection, small endometrial polyp or small cervical polyp, and additions in the coronal cones and coronal polyp, which will be usually missed. And unless we rule out that, we cannot explain even as unexplained infection. So this is for example for that. The first picture is a flimsy adhesion inside the uterine cavity. You can see small flimsy, which we'll never see in the scan. And in the second, you can see a dense adhesion inside the uterine cavity, which of course we can see as a bright spot inside the uterine cavity. Or there can be a dense adhesion between anterior and posterior wall in the uterine cavity, which we can dissect using the scissors. That is the advantage. Some cases you can see in the scan. Some you may not. Of course, if you can remove that additions, we can get a clear uterine cavity inside the uterine cavity. Okay. Or there can be coronal small polyps will be there, all small cervical polyps which can be there, which usually may not be seen in the scan. So next question is, should hysteroscopy be used routinely at the time of laparoscopy for investigation of a infertility? Most of the people agree to that as a routine. If you do a laparoscopy in a patient for infertile patient, you have to do hysteroscopy with that. And hysterolaparoscopy is considered as the gold standard for infertile treatment, as it is not only the diagnostic but also the therapeutic procedures can be done in the same sitting. So the potential uterine cavity, when we distance using the distension media, it can leak through the cervix, it can leak through the tubes, or it can intravasate. So initially people were using carbon dioxide. This is a separate carbon dioxide insufflator, is from istroflator, not the routine laparoscopic carbon dioxide insufflator. But carbon dioxide can be used only for diagnostic purpose. There is always risk of gas embolism and carbon dioxide intoxication. Most commonly used is the fluid, and most widely used is the low viscosity saline, which is an electrolyte, or non-electrolyte glycine when used is monopolar. Initially people were using dextran. And this is the typical picture of a routine is from a rigid hysteroscope. It can consist as a scope which could be put in an inner sheath, and over that, if you are using continuous flow, you have to use outer sheath also. This is an obturator for keeping that. So when we will introduce with the scope with the inner sheath, and then if we are a continuous flow with the outer sheath. And this is a picture of a resector scope, where the diameter is more, initially 8 millimeter. Now even we have 7 millimeter resector scope, where we can use loop or different type of electrolytes with continuous flow. And this is office hysteroscope, which is very thin, but the problem is it is very costly and easily damageable, cost more than 6 lakhs. So that is the problem when we use office hysteroscope. But most commonly what I use is the rigid hysteroscope with combined with the operative and operative scope. That means outer sheath, it comes less than 4 millimeter. So there is a water inlet, water outlet is there, and we can introduce the instrument which is straight. So we have continuous flow, all the instruments we can put through a channel with that. So this is one model. Another model is there where the scope is straight and the instruments is channel is little angled. But the advantage with this is that instruments can be output straight, but the problem is that it is integrated system, so the vision won't be that good. All energy source we can use, this is monopolar, which we can use with the integrated system or with the spectroscope what you have seen, or we can use other instruments like Rasper scissors with the whatever be the instruments what you are using. Whatever be the instruments, we have to have a pressures to distend the uterine cavity. Simply, we can use a gravity fall system when the source of fluid is above 1 meter above the patient's perineum, giving approximately 970 millimeters of mercury, or we can use a pressure cuff. But recommended is to use a proper histomat. This is one model, this is another model. Principle is that the tube is being squeezed by the roller ball in both the models, so the pressure won't exceed too much and the chance of air embolism is less, because we don't have to put air pressure above the fluid column. You will start suck the fluid from the closed tube, so the chance of air embolism is less. The next is the bipolar energy source, for which we need not have to use the glycine. If the current travels from one part to the other, or we can have different tips, or even loop electrodes are also there with the bipolar energy source. But in infertile patients, even for IVF patients, what we are concerned is that lesions inside the uterine cavity, like fibroid, polyp, or adhesions, or septum, or a regular endometrium. So this is one picture of a polyp, a typical polyp, which if you want to remove, you have to hold the base and ovules and take. This picture, I just put it, this is a little older picture. Initially, when the distension is not there, we won't get the proper view of the uterine cavity. If the pressure is not adequate, or if you are not using a proper pressure system, or if there is fluid leak from the cervix, you see that it is not getting properly distended. But if you are, if you get proper distension, you can see small polyp in one side of the cavity, which you will miss if you don't get a proper distension of the uterine cavity. So the same thing what we can remove using the same sitting. This can be done even with a smaller scope, which is less than 4 millimeter. You can use where if you see any lesion, we have to just introduce the instrument through that. If it is even a septum, we have to just change into glycine and use the monopolar electrode. Or if you see a foreign body like this, this is a polyp inside the uterine cavity. This patient came for ART. It was atypical, endometrium was atypical. When we did, there was a foreign tubular implantation polyps there. This is another picture of a bone inside post abortion inside the uterine cavity. You can see big bone pieces. When you see bone pieces, must not do the curetting, because if it is an older bone piece, it will become friable and go into the endometrium in deep. Otherwise, we have to distend and take out with the grasper. A piecemeal we have to take out to have a proper endometrial cavity at the end of the procedure. This is the bone piece which you obtained from the hysteroscope. Okay, so next is the septum. Septum. This is the typical one, the right side with the Collins electrode, which is people usually do, but we have to distend the uterine, dilate the cervix up to 7 millimeter, or we can use the same integrated system or small other Batocci or the Wolf, Solumasupi, whatever be the source. We can introduce some small Bugby electrode through the operating channel, just change into glycine because it is monopolar and complete the procedure. Whatever be that, at the end, we can get a complete, we have to have a proper look, and whether it is a resector scope or a smaller scope. Or if it is a smaller septum, we can use the scissors alone. This is a case of a smaller septum, where we can use no need of energy source of septum. We can use a scissors for that. If you have an advanced gadget like a morcellator is there, we can use for a submucosal myoma or polyp, you can use a morcellator. This is a speeded version of a video where morcellator can be used for intrauterine lesion. But only thing is integrated system, it is very costly. We cannot incorporate with the routine scope what we are having in our system. So when should hysteroscopy done in ART? So this is one famous trial, TROPHY trial, came in 2016. They're telling that outpatient hysteroscopy before IVF, woman with normal ultrasound of uterine cavity and history of unsuccessful IVF treatment does not improve the live birth. But this is another study which came in 2008, hysteroscopy in women with implantation failure after IVF. And they concluded that women with two implantation failure after IVF had a remarkably high possibility of unsuspected abnormality seen at hysteroscopy. If you look into that, this is the study in detail. There was abnormal normal hysteroscopy findings in 540 out of that, where unsuspected cases was 328. And polyp also, if you see, there were few unsuspected cases. Polyp usually won't miss. But if you look into the other, like endometrial adhesions, endometritis or endocervical adhesions, almost all the patients were not suspected in the scan. That is the importance of hysteroscopy. So when they analyzed post repeat IVF in those patients, they had a good clinical pregnancy in all the groups. And they analyzed in subset of when they, in those subset where they suspected or not suspected in the scan, you can see that in all the cases, there was a very significant difference if you take all the abnormalities together. And so definitely, with two implantation failure of IVF, they came to the conclusion that there is a need for hysteroscopy before going for a repeated IVF in those patients. Okay, so this is another study of role of hysteroscopy prior to ART procedures came in 2013 in Journal of Minimally Invasive Gynecology. Diagnosis of it should be performed before ART in all patients, including women with normal TVS or HST findings, because significant percentage of them have undiagnosed uterine disease that may impair the success of fertility and outcome. That was the conclusion of that. So there are a lot of other studies also, a number of studies are there, where in repeated IVF failure cases, we have to do hysteroscopy. But what is the role of hysteroscopy prior to first IVF cycle? This is one study by the Jolsina Pundir from UK. They're telling that number need to treat for that is hysteroscopy to achieve one additional clinical pregnancy was 10, and to achieve live pregnancy was 11. To have a positive result, that is NNT is 10 and 11 for clinical pregnancy and live birth, that is came into reproductive biomedicine in 2014. So coming to the PIP study, that is people for pregnancy study, thus endometrial scratching delivered an by people increase the probability of live birth in IVF embryo transfer. Endometrial scratching was not associated with any improvement in live birth. That was the conclusion. This is another study came in the RBM online in 2019. They're telling that this study suggests endometrial injury is beneficial for RIF patients to increase the odds of implantation. That is hysteroscopic endometrial injury. There specifically that the study was focused on that. And this is a Cochrane data by the our own Indian Mohan Kamath from Vellore, and also Sri Vindhya Seshadri and Sesh Sungakara from UK. That in women undergoing IVF, low quality evidence, including all the studies reporting this outcome, suggests that performing screening hysteroscopy before IVF may increase live birth rate and clinical pregnancy rate. However, pooled results from only two trials with low risk bias did not show a benefit of screening of hysteroscopic before IVF. And since the studies, they are telling that hysteroscopy increases live birth and clinical pregnancy with all women or those with two IVF or more failed IVF attempts. At present, there is no high quality evidence to support the routine hysteroscopy as a screening tool for all supported women with normal ultrasound or HST as a basic infertile workup hysteroscopy has got no role. So to conclude, pre-IRT or IVF hysteroscopy, yes, for suspect, if you are suspected lesion on ultrasound, yes, in a repeated implantation failure or two or more failed IVF, and no for all patients undergoing IVF. I'm not, since the time is less, I'm not going to the addition prevention part post IVF because it was specifically limited to the pre-IVF.